Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for coming to the University of San Francisco today. I'd like to thank the Dean of the Business School, Elizabeth Davis, and the Associate Dean of the Business School, Barry Doyle, for making these great events possible at the University of San Francisco. I also want to thank our film crew, and I'd like to especially thank LaShonda Small and Susan Ewens and their team for help in organizing this event. I'd also like to thank Irina Pozlovsky, and she knows why. Before we begin, I kindly ask you to turn your cell phones off so we can hear the guest speaker. If you have questions for the guest speaker, please write them down on an index card that is available, passed around, and hand them in at the end, and we will screen them and ask questions. If you love to tweet, then you can tweet to hashtag USFSOM with all your comments. We're basically going to do a 30-minute lecture, and then we will do a Q&A session for about 30 minutes as well. Okay, so write your questions down. Our guest speaker helped make lending easier for people. Our guest speaker built a company that allows a regular person to get a loan at 13% a year instead of 22% a year with a credit card. Our guest speaker also built a company that allows an investor like me to get 6% from my returns instead of zero in a savings account. Our guest speaker was born and raised in France. He received an undergraduate degree from the University of Montpellier and an MBA from the HEC Business School in Paris. In 2000, he used his credit cards to start a company named Matchpoint. Matchpoint was bought by Oracle in 2005. One thing about that experience bothered Renaud. He couldn't believe how much interest he was paying on his credit card that he used to finance that company. Even after he became a millionaire, he still was being charged 18% on credit card debt. He thought there must be a better way. If you could screen out the top quality borrowers, you should be able to lower the rates that they pay while giving investors the opportunity to make great returns by lending to those people. This matching of lenders and borrowers is referred to as peer-to-peer lending. After some months of thinking, he decided to call the company Lending Club. Unfortunately, someone else had the URL, but he bought it for $17,000. Lending Club was not the first in the space. There was another player known as Prosper. However, Renaud believed by offering a slightly better product, he could succeed anyway, and so he launched his company in May 2007. The company had immediate success. In September 2007, they issued 373,000 in new loans, and by March 2008, loan volume had grown to 4.2 billion. Sorry, million. That growth is amazing. Now I have to quote Ronald Reagan. Government's view of the economy should be summed up in a few short phrases. If it moves, tax it. If it keeps moving, regulate it. And if it stops, subsidize it. Why do I mention that? Because the SEC believed that Lending Club's notes were in fact securities that had to be registered with the SEC. Thus, Lending Club had to shut down their business for 6 months and spend $4 million to get registered. It was tough, but they succeeded. By 2012, they had moved their company to downtown San Francisco, had crossed the $1 billion mark in total loans issued, and had received a $15 million equity investment from Kleiner Perkins. By 2015, just this last year, they have $8 billion in loan origination. Now, I'm going to mention a couple more things about Lending Club. You've heard the statement, it's a small world, so I want to tell you how small world it is. The founder of the firm that gave Renaud the money for Lending Club was Tom Perkins, and he was a guest speaker here 2 years ago at USF. The brokerage firm that I built many years ago helped distribute Lending Club's products when they needed a secondary market for their products. And finally, one of my former students, Mike Taormina, started the peer-to-peer lending firm Common Bun. So it's a small world. Let me give you a couple more examples of how Lending Club helps people. Zachary Knight wanted to finish his training for a helicopter license. He needed a loan to do it. He went to Chase Bank, and after filling out tons of paperwork, they told him 33% a year. He thought it was too high, and he went to Lending Club. He applied for a 3-year, $10,000 loan, and Lending Club gave him a loan for 13%. That was a few years ago. He's paid it off, and he got his license. In addition to building Lending Club, Renaud loves to sail. Last year, he and his team set 3 world sailing records. One of their records was the Trans-Pacific sailing route from Long Beach to Hawaii, which they did, I believe, in 3 days and 20 hours. He told me the secret to good sailing is lots of planning and preparation, good weather forecasting, and finally, good data and good people, similar to what you need for a business. Renaud has signed this book that's about Lending Club, and we will put it in the Dean's Library. I would like you guys to be as grateful as I am that Renaud is here today. Please listen to his amazing story. Please give a warm welcome for Mr. Renaud LaPlanche.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody. I'm really, really glad to be here. Lending Club is a company I created about 9 years ago now. And just to give you a few statistics about what it is today and where it stands. So we are based here in San Francisco, just a few blocks away on 71 Stevenson. We are serving mostly consumers, consumer loans, but also small businesses. We now have about 1,500 employees, and we've facilitated since inception about $16 billion in loans, including $8 billion just last year. We've helped along the way 1.4 million customers. So and we're now a publicly traded company. We did our IPO in December 2014 on the New York Stock Exchange. One statistic that the one that I like the most is that we are now the largest provider of personal loans in America, with that $8 billion we did last year. Wells Fargo is number 2 with $6 billion, and Discover is number 3. So the idea, I think Ludwig sort of gave away part of the story here, but the idea really came to me not only when I found that I was paying, or I would be paying if I was going to carry over the balance on my credit card, I would be paying a very high rate of 18%, which happens to be the average interest rate on credit cards. But then the next piece of mail I opened after opening my credit card statement was a savings account statement. And then I realized that I was earning 0.5% interest rate. So that felt like a big spread between the interest rate you're supposed to pay to the bank on your credit card and the interest rate that the bank pays you on your savings account for what seems to be the same money. So I started thinking about that spread and about what's causing the spread. And pretty soon I realized that a lot of that spread goes towards funding the high cost of operations of the banks. The cost of thousands of branches, tens of thousands of employees that focus on this pretty inefficient process of collecting deposits on one side and then turning around and making loans on the other side through this process of maturity transformation. So the very basic question I asked myself at that time was, okay, would there be a more cost-efficient way to allocate capital between the source of capital on one side, the depositors or the investors, and the use of capital on the other side, the consumers and small businesses? And whether a sort of online marketplace would be such a more cost-efficient mechanism and could operate at a lower cost than the banks. So that's really what Lending Club is today. It's an online marketplace. We have investors on one side who provide the capital, and borrowers on the other side, and we in the middle sort of underwrite the loans, price the loans, and service the loans on behalf of investors. So we have a sort of pretty wide variety of borrowers and investors. I think the reason borrowers come to us in general is really to get a lower interest rate than they would get from their bank. We operate at a lower cost, and we pass on these cost savings to both borrowers and investors, and are able to give them a better deal. I think we also provide a more responsible product than the traditional way of borrowing an unsecured credit, which tends to be a credit card, which is often a unsecured variable interest rate and a revolving mechanism. So you have no obligation to amortize down the balance every month. But the loans that we provide are installment loans, meaning that you have to, with a straight line amortization, so you have to pay back principal and interest every month. So it's good to force yourself into that discipline. On the investor side, we also have a very wide variety of investors, from individual investors to institutional investors, with sort of accounts that have a sort of $50 account and are invested in two loans, all the way to $1.5 billion being our largest investor, a large institutional investor. And generally, what investors really like is the ability to earn a better return than they would earn elsewhere, but also the sense that they understand the return. So it's very different than investing in a complex hedge fund structure where it's really hard, there's no transparency and it's hard to understand where the gains really come from. Yeah, it's lending money to people, the people pay you back, and if we do a good job at underwriting, you earn the interest. And we have now 9 years of track record of underwriting and servicing, so you have a good sense of what the outcome is. And there's a lot of transparency around the quality of the loans and the returns, and a lot of control for investors. So you can go on our website and download the entire loan tape. So all the loans we've ever made for the last 9 years on a non-nominative basis, obviously. But you see every loan and the credit quality of every single loan and the performance of every loan. And then the loans are graded from A through G. And as an investor, you can decide where you want to play and how aggressive or conservative you want to be. So the two ways we use technology, or the two purpose of technology for us, is one, to lower cost, and two, to deliver a better experience than what you would get at a traditional institution. So on the cost side, a bank typically spends 5 to 7% of their sort of outstanding balance, outstanding loan balance, towards operating cost, and the cost that goes into the branch network, the reserve requirements, and all the customer acquisition, underwriting, and servicing. At Lending Club, the same metric is only 2%. So only 2% of total loan balance goes towards funding the operations. So we have a 3 to 5% or 300 to 500 basis points cost advantage against the traditional system. So the cost advantage comes from really two mechanisms. One, there are costs that we don't incur at all. So we don't have a branch network. We operate in a way that's fully online. And we also do not have reserve requirements because we don't take deposits. And then there are the costs that we do incur, but we use technology to automate processes and lower costs. So everything about our customer acquisition, the servicing, and the underwriting is fully automated. So the other benefit of technology and automation is as we're available online, we're available 24/7, and as we're more automated and more sort of electronic, we provide a easier experience, easier process for consumers. So the way we measure how good a job we do at satisfying our customers is for a metric called the NPS, the Net Promoter Score, that essentially measures the likelihood for our customers to recommend our products to their friends and colleagues. It's not a percentage, it's essentially the way you get to that metric is by adding all the people who said they would recommend you and then subtract the one who said they wouldn't. So on using that metric, we have a NPS of about 78, which is very high by any standards, but particularly in banking, where the average for community banks is actually pretty good, it's in the 60s, but then the average overall is only in the 20s, and the average for large credit card issuers and national banks is only in the single digits. So the way most of our customers use the product is really to pay off an existing or refinance an existing credit card balance. So there are 800 and actually now $930 billion of credit card balances outstanding in the US. And these credit cards carry interest on average at 17 to 18%. So the opportunity for our customers to refinance that balance with a lending club loan at 12 or 13% creates a sort of massive saving opportunity of more than 700 basis points, which applied to a $14,000 balance is more than $1,000 of savings every year. So it's really meaningful. And then the second product we have is for small business owners. So we make larger loans all the way to $300,000 to businesses that are typically not new businesses, but are established businesses, but that are too small to really be attractive customers for banks. It's very hard, especially for big banks, to make a $50,000 or $60,000 small business loan because of the high fixed cost of underwriting and servicing. So small balance commercial loans are really hard for the banks to make profitably. And for that, you need a low operating cost, which is really what Lending Club is about. So as I said, on the investor side of the platform, we have built out a lot of diversity. And so we started with retail investors, so individual investors coming to our website and building their own portfolio. And then over time, we've expanded to add institutional investors and what we call high net worth individuals and family offices, pension plans, insurance companies. And we believe the diversity of capital is a source of resiliency for the business, because in different economic environment and different rate environment, different investors will have sort of different behavior and investment objectives. So that diversity, we believe, will help us go through different cycles. So I talked before about the transparency and the amount of data and information that we make available. It's really a key tenet of online marketplaces. It's the ability to collect a lot of data and make that data available to the user to empower the user. And so this is what a sort of investor screen looks like. And you can essentially build a portfolio, a very diversified portfolio of loans. And it's a many-to-many relationship. So if an investor comes in with $10,000 and there are many $10,000 loans available, an investor is not going to invest in a single loan. The investor would most likely take a, say, $25 fraction of 400 different loans. 400 times 25, yeah, that works, 10,000. And so that really helps be very diversified and help generate more predictable return that way. And then again, we provide a lot of data, both at the time of the time the portfolio gets built, and investors can be sort of as involved as they want to be in the portfolio portfolio creation. Often what we see is the first portfolio, investors really sort of look at every loan detail and do a lot of research about every loan. And then the sort of entertainment value of the process starts to fade, and a lot of investors switch to what we call automated investing, where you set some criteria and then the algorithm does the work for you. And so investors have rewarded us with a lot of loyalty. So this chart shows the average account value by vintage of account opening. You can see that all the lines go up and to the right, and that new accounts, so the shorter lines, or more recently open account, typically have are activated at a higher amount and have grown faster than account opened 3 or 4 years ago, which means that we're doing a better job at making investors feel confident earlier in the process, which is a lot of what our our sort of transparency and availability of data is designed to do. It's designed to show investors that they can trust us, and there's a long track record. So a pretty common misconception about what's now called marketplace lending and lending club is that we're not regulated. We're actually pretty well regulated. There are two kinds of banking regulations. There are banking regulations that are designed to protect borrowers. So these are truthful lending, fair lending, Reg B, so fair credit opportunity, fair debt collections, fair credit reporting. So all these regulations apply to us the same way they would apply to a bank. And the borrower taking a lending club loan would be sort of getting the same protection as a borrower getting a loan from Citibank. And in fact, all the loans we facilitate are issued by a bank. So we partner with issuing banks. The only set of regulations that don't apply to us have to do with the protection of depositors. So FDIC insurance, reserve requirements, and they don't apply for a good reason. It's because we don't take deposits. We offer direct investments. So investors are protected by the SEC. So I think besides lending club and marketplace lending, there's been a lot of new companies created in the last 10 years around the idea of fintech, of applying technology for delivering better financial services. And that has happened in payments, in asset management, in lending, in personal finance management, and a lot of that has happened in San Francisco, which is really good news. And so a lot of these companies really rely on three fundamental advantages they have over a bank. One is technology. It's a new technology that doesn't have to deal with the IT sort of legacy systems that the banks have to deal with. I think if Wells Fargo was created today, they would build it in a very different way than the way it was, the way it has grown both organically and through acquisitions over the last many decades. There's also technology is really a big, new modern technology stack is a big benefit of starting from a blank page. The way we use data and the way we're focused on data is also a key benefit. And our belief that automation delivers a lot of value, and it's a gift that keeps on giving, because when you automate a process once, it's going to run more efficiently forever. And not only automation lowers cost, it also often helps deliver a better customer experience, and also I think helps motivate employees, because if you're a sort of talented employee, you really don't want to do the same repetitive task over and over again. So if a task is simple and repetitive, it should be automated so that employees can focus on tasks that are more interesting and more sort of diverse. I'm moving a lot, so I think the microphone is getting tangled into my belt. So the better technology for marketplace lending and fintech in general essentially enables five sort of benefits. One is a better customer experience. Second is better value, better delivery of credit through partnerships, increased transparency, and better compliance and risk management, which is another benefit of automation. When the process is automated, you get better reporting, you get better data, you get more standardized data, and you have a better audit capability on that data. So starting with the experience, what customers say is that they want online application. They don't want to go to a branch, particularly the millennials. They haven't grown up with a branch environment, and they're very comfortable operating online. But only 32%, only less than a third of the banks actually offer an online application, which seems to be the basics, but it's only available at a third of the banks. The second really sort of key benefit is offering a better value. So the average interest rate on Lending Club is just over 12%. The average on interest rate on credit cards is a third higher, or rather the rate you get on Lending Club is a third lower than what you'd get on a credit card. That's the equation I showed earlier. That's the way our customers save more than $1,000 per year. I think another key benefit of technology is distribution. So we announced a $150 million program with Citibank last year that was really designed to bring affordable credit to areas where Citibank does not have a branch network. And it was a CRA program, community redevelopment program, that was sort of specifically targeting sort of low and moderate income areas. And the ability to deliver the service online really helped sort of reach out to populations that didn't have access to a branch. Increased transparency. So I mentioned before that we sort of make a lot of data available, but we also make a lot of analytics available. So if you don't want to crunch your own data, we do it for you, and you can sort of plot on a chart your own returns and how that return compares to other investor returns, and there are even sort of some groups of investors who do their own sort of little competition around sort of who's going to have the winning strategy on Lending Club. So it gets really exciting. And data also helps with sort of compliance and risk management. So this is a tool that we've developed with data from the Drug Administration, with data also the Drug Enforcement Agency, data from the financial services, financial crime agencies, that overlay essentially different sort of risk areas by the sort of reported occurrence of risk. And we overlay this with some of our own risk factors and are able to detect potential fraud a lot faster with that type of visualization tools. And so the advances of fintech, as exciting as they are, I think can also benefit from the traditional banks. And I think the addition or the collaboration of banks and platforms like ours can deliver a lot of value to customers. So we've announced last year a partnership with a network of 200 community banks across the country, which together will be the fourth largest bank in the country. So it's a lot of small banks, but together a lot of volume. And we help them essentially level the playing field with the big banks. So we have a partnership whereby the banks can become an investor on the platform, so they can buy loans from Lending Club and invest a lot of their sort of existing deposits. and this way gain access to a low-cost origination platform. And that's powered by technology that the bank, each individual bank, wouldn't have the resources or the skill set and the talent employee pool necessary to build. And that way, we essentially create the best possible collaboration, the best possible combination of resources between Lending Club and the bank. Because if you think of the cost of credit, it's really the addition of the cost of operations plus the cost of capital. And Lending Club has the lowest possible cost of operations for a very modern technology stack and a constant focus on automation. But the banks have a very low cost of capital through deposits and borrowing from the Fed. So this low cost of capital plus low cost of operations equals the lowest possible cost of credit for consumers. And that's really our goal at the end of the day, is to make credit more affordable for consumers and businesses, but also on the other side, make investing more rewarding. And we use technology and partnership to achieve these two objectives. Thank you.
So, So what is the life investment you're most proud of and why?
Well, I think Landing Club, right? It gets really interesting when you start thinking of investment in terms of what's the most precious, because investment, typically you think about investing money, which certainly is a precious commodity, but then I think the most precious thing we have is time, and we have a limited amount of it. And so when I think of an investment, I think of, okay, where do I invest my time? And Landing Club has been a sort of amazing sort of 10-year adventure that so far has turned out really well.
Great. What is one of your worst mistakes in building this company, and how did you overcome it?
Yeah, so I think a mistake that I made and young entrepreneurs often make is around recruiting, and especially when you receive venture capital funding. Because then at that point, there's a lot of expectation for fast growth. And the way you get high valuation from a VC is by showing a growth curve that's very steep. And I think once the capital comes in, there's a lot of pressure to put that capital to work. And often in a service business, putting the capital to work means hiring more people. Hiring top talent just takes time. And each time I compromised on talent, I recreated it later. And so it's really sort of absolutely critical to sort of get the right person in the right seat and really spend the time to measure not only the specifics of technical skill sets, but also the personal fit and the cultural fit, and really sort of thinking about the kind of company you want to build and the kind of people you want around you.
Okay. What's one of your best moments in building either this company or the last company?
I think with Landing Club, it was a day when, when we got started, I think I knew personally all the investors on the platform, and they all sort of lived in a sort of 15-mile radius from Palo Alto, which is where we got started. And it was a hard sell, right? We were essentially selling, offering consumer credit in 2008, in the middle of the biggest credit crisis since the Great Depression. And we were offering in a very novel way. And I think there was this one day in 2009 when we received a check in the mail of $50,000 for an investor that none of us known. It was a complete stranger. So we said, okay, that's this person who none of us has talked to, who trusts us enough to send us a $50,000 check. So that was really a big
awesome.
A big day. Yeah.
What is the greatest misconception about building a company?
I don't know if it's a greatest, but it's a misconception I know I had at some point, but a lot of value was in having good ideas. And I think it's certainly true. I mean, good ideas are better than bad ideas. But so much more of the value comes from execution. Mm-hmm. And there are a lot of people who have the same idea or similar ideas. And sometimes there are strategic decisions that make a difference, but very often it's small tactical decisions. It's about hiring the right person, the right fit for that role. Or it's about sort of making really sort of small, the 20 little decisions you're going to make every day that in aggregate are going to make a big difference. So it's really a lot more about execution than the big idea or the big sort of strategic decision.
Okay. What is, shifting gears a little bit, can you name something that you learned in school, honestly learned in school, and helped you in business today?
No. No, of course. I think my sort of favorite times at business school was really case studies. And so we worked on so many case studies where I learned so much, and especially working in small groups of three or four people, we always had sort of So different input. I think it's one of these sort of small group sessions that really made me realize the power of sort of diversity and sort of bringing different people from different background, different experiences, contributing to the ideas. We did this really interesting session in business school that was called Lost at Sea. And the exercise was, okay, you're in the middle of the ocean, your ship is sinking, you have a very small sort of inflatable canoe, you can only take five of these 30 items. Which five are you taking? And so there are two sides of the class, a side that was sort of working on this individually and sort of picking their own five items, and then a side of the class that was working by a group of four people. And then there was a sort of marine expert who came in and told everybody why they were going to be dead in 2 days, so who would survive. And the lowest group score was higher than the highest individual score. Wow. And that really showed in some sort of specific settings how group discussions help reach a better outcome.
Wow, that's interesting. Is there something that someone in your family taught you that you use today in business that helps you with your business life?
Well, my dad was the best businessman ever. He had a grocery store in the south of France. And I think the key lesson he taught me was to raise money when you can, not when you need it. And so I think it's especially in Silicon Valley, it's a great learning, because Silicon Valley, more than any other place, goes through cycles in terms of venture capital funding and availability of angel investments. And it's really important to remember that it doesn't last forever. And sometimes valuations are really high and you can do a great fundraising and you should take it at that time and not be greedy, because it's not always going to last and you're going to need the money at some point.
Okay, great. By the way, you might want to get out there and raise some money. So this is more for students, and then we're going to take the questions that people have written. What is one thing that you would change about your career path?
So I worked for a law firm for 6 years.
I feel bad for you.
That's the answer.
Okay. What is the greatest factor that contributes to an intern? I don't know if you hire interns, but what is the factor that when you see an intern working for you could lead to you hiring them full time?
So I think a couple of things we look for are really about, the questions I always ask at interviews isn't so much about experience and about what you know, because at the end of the day, you're going to learn so many new things. It doesn't matter what you know when you come in. It's really about the mindset of sort of wanting to learn, wanting to discover, try new things, innovate, fail, and learn from it. And also a level of passion from the business. I think the most sort of highly engaged employees that we have are the ones who sort of truly believe in that mission on the wall, and truly believe that technology is not just a tool. Technology is a way to change people's lives for the better. And affordable credit isn't just a concept, right? It's making credit more affordable can make the difference for a family between sending their kids to college or not. Or for a small business owner, the difference between sort of hiring a couple more people or buying more inventory ahead of the holiday season, or buying new equipment and be more successful. So credit is really the lifeblood of the economy, and our ability to use technology to make a profound difference in people's life at the end of the day is what drives the employees. And so we look for that passion in everybody we hire.
Okay, great. So passion is the big word. And what do you think could be done to teach business or finance better in university?
Oh, I haven't been at university for such a long time. I don't know.
Okay.
You tell me. I don't know. Yeah. I think they. So I'm a pretty so frequent guest lecturer at Columbia, and I really like the way they it's self-serving, but the way they invite sort of CEOs for like speaking opportunities, because it's such a great opportunity to sort of exchange information and tell students about sort of what we the CEOs or the entrepreneurs care about. And really learn from the student what they care about, because I think especially the millennials who are at school now have such different sort of interests and values, and their values in the workforce in the sort of work environment is sometimes very different from the generation before. So I think facilitating this type of exchange I think is really useful for students, but it's incredibly useful for us as well.
Great. So on that, what three pieces of advice would you give to young business people today?
I think one clear thing that I learned is really not to be afraid of failing. I think sort of any attempt at building a company is going to teach you something. I think we are launching new products, we're constantly sort of trying new things, and in a way that's very iterative and very nimble, and we are sort of not afraid of putting a beta version of a product out there, and customers are going to tell us they hate it, and we put it back in the box and we try something different, and I think that's really a quality of sort of not being your own sort of barrier, but the opposite of trying new things and testing and learning. It's something I didn't necessarily have going out of school, but I learned over time. And then the other, I'm going to say it again because it's so critical. It's about sort of surrounding yourself with the right people for that particular job, for that particular sort of company culture you're trying to create. And for the relationship you want to have with that person, especially choosing a co-founder, it's probably going to be the person you're going to spend sort of 10 to 12 hours with for the next 10 years of your life. So you're going to spend more time with that person than with your significant other. So whether it's choosing a co-founder or choosing the early employees and every other employee after that is going to make a fundamental difference in the success of the company. What we've seen is that exceptional people attract other exceptional people, while sort of people who are just not as sort of motivated, engaged, and are not doing something that truly sort of excites them will be sort of hiring other people like them, and it's all downhill from there. I think making these key hiring decisions is absolutely critical.
Okay, great. Can I get the questions? So basically, summary was don't be afraid of failure, and choose the right people.
Right.
Thanks. Okay, excellent. We have tons of them here. We're going to be going all night here. In your opinion, how large of a role does luck play in starting and carrying out a successful business?
I think it. I think luck plays a big role if you make sort of concentrated bets, right? If you're trying this one big thing you're going to work on for 2 years, and it's either going to fail or succeed. It's going to be partly based on strategy and execution, but there's going to be a share of luck. I think the way I like to place bets is to place smaller bets. In that case, it's more of a sort of diversification and a portfolio approach, and luck plays a really small role because one of these things is going to work. Statistically, out of like 10 bad ideas I'm going to have on any given day, there's going to be one that's okay.
Okay. How does Lending Club have an edge over Lending Tree and other lending sites?
So LendingTree does something quite different. LendingTree is a lead aggregator. So they acquire traffic, they advertise, and then they essentially sell leads to banks and other lenders and platforms like ours. So they don't go through the process of underwriting and pricing and issuing and servicing the loans. So we believe by sort of providing all these services, we develop more of a relationship with the customers and have a sort of higher lifetime value of customers. We learn a lot more about our customers because we have this 3 or 5 years relationship, and we collect a lot of data, and we learn about their behavior. We learn about how responsible they are in their payment, and we have this at least monthly interaction with our customers. So we think we create more value that way.
Okay. What is the key strategy that allows LendingClub to grow more rapidly than your competitors? And so I'll leave it at that. I don't understand the rest.
I think for marketplaces, especially online marketplaces, there are a lot of network effects and benefits of scale that make the larger marketplace more attractive and more efficient as it gets larger. And so people often ask me whether it's a winner-takes-all type of scenario like eBay was 10 years ago, or if it's just a sort of big premium to the leader. And we don't know how it's going to play out, but we know that at the minimum, there's a big premium to the leader because as you gain scale, you get more data, you get smarter about making decisions. Borrowers, you have more borrowers, so investors have more choices, but you have more investors so that borrowers are getting funded faster. And then there's more liquidity so that investors can maybe invest more capital because they know they can sell their loans to other investors if they need to get out. So there are so many benefits in being the larger marketplace. And what we've seen also is one specific network effect is as we got bigger and as we had a longer track record, investors were sort of more confident in our underwriting and servicing, so they were willing to take a lower return from us than from our smaller competitors because there was more certainty to that return. And so that enables us to lower the interest rate to the borrowers, essentially pass on these savings to borrowers, and sort of have lower acquisition costs, generate better borrower quality because the better borrowers are attracted to the lowest rates. And by having a better borrower quality, we continue to beef up the track record and continue to attract better investors. So really each side of the marketplace is accretive to the other side, which is really the definition of a network effect.
Okay, great. So this is a question, I'm gonna add on to this question. The question is, what does Wall Street not understand about LendingClub? So I wanna add on to that by saying the stock has been going down since the IPO, and there's SOFI, there's Prosper, there's Common Bond. And so my question is, with this person, what does Wall Street not get? But also, is it possible that this market could get saturated, and therefore there's a limit to what can happen?
So first, it's a generous way to ask the question. The question could have been, what don't I get about Wall Street? which could be a longer answer. It's been quite interesting. We went public at $15 a share, and we are now sort of twice as much revenue. We are 3 times more profitable than we were at that time, and our share price is around $7. So we certainly haven't been rewarded for our execution. I think there's been a few things going on. I mean, first of multiples, valuation multiples have come down since December 2014. I think we went out at a sort of really good time, really good valuation. So you see a lot of other, especially mid-cap technology companies like sort of Etsy, Zillow, Yelp, or even GoPro, Pandora, that are also sort of way down from their high. So I think we've been following the same trend. I think there's also there are some concerns about investors about sort of whether we would be sort of more regulated at some point, and whether sort of new regulations is going to create more friction. There are concerns about our ability to go through the next economic cycle. And I think we're certainly very well equipped with a very diversified marketplace, but we still need to prove that out. And to your point, I think last year there were concerns about how crowded the field was getting with a lot of competitors, new competitors coming out. I think that's less of a concern now. I think there's more of a sense that there are benefits of scale and there are network effects, and probably the larger marketplace is going to continue to get ahead.
Okay, thank you. I saw Lending Club. So the question is, Lending Club partners with Wells Fargo and other banks. This is what they're writing. And what specifically is that relationship? Aren't they supposed to be competitors?
Yeah, we're really both. I think we're both competitors and partners. The point I was trying to make about the complementarity of banks and technology platforms like ours. We have the lowest possible cost of operations, but the banks have a very low cost of capital, and they also have a big customer base. And so we partner with some banks, for example, to make personal loans to the bank's customers. With many community banks, the bank is not a credit card issuer. Right? So the bank might have a mortgage customer, but that mortgage customer also has a Citibank card and carries a balance on that card. So the bank is very interested in Lending Club helping the bank make a personal loan to that customer and for the bank to invest in that loan. And it's a way to recapture a balance away from Citibank. Right? So it's a way to for the community bank to sort of have a sort of deeper relationship with a customer, offer more products that they didn't have, and would be really hard for the bank to deliver as efficiently as we do.
Okay, thank you. Based on what you said, I just have to ask this question. So banks upset me because I have always been upset in the fact that, and that's why we did a brokerage firm, but that the brokerage industry, the banking industry seems to be so inefficient. In this sense, I can't believe I'm earning zero on my savings account. I mean, I think it's crazy. So what I don't understand, maybe this is a weird question to ask, is why aren't banks doing something like what you're doing and letting us get the money on our savings accounts?
Yeah, so I think it's hard for banks to sort of radically transform themselves and become a much more sort of nimble, technology-enabled, technology-powered, low-cost version of themselves. If you look back at the history of innovation, that doesn't happen very often, right? When you get a big technology disruptor, it's hard for the incumbent to, again, spin off a low-cost version of themselves. Some have managed to do so, but I mean, it certainly didn't happen in the with Amazon and Borders. It didn't happen with sort of Netflix and Blockbusters. It didn't happen with, there are so many other examples of the technology-enabled disruptor sort of just moving too fast and innovating too fast and sort of using data and being completely in touch with customers and the large incumbents with a lot of legacy cost sort of really not being able to respond fast enough.
So that leads to another question that we have here, which is related. So what do you see the future of fintech companies, and do you think a lot of them will be bought by a bigger established bank?
I think it's possible. I think it's a path for banks to get in our business is to sort of rather than venturing into sort of creating that platform, trying to buy one. But we've seen a couple of attempts already that haven't been successful. because often what's happening, I mean, it's hard for the bank to sort of acquire a platform and leave it alone and really perpetrate all the good things about that platform in terms of being low cost and nimble and sort of agile, fast sort of decision making abilities. When the banks have acquired platforms, they've often sort of brought in their, and sometimes they have to, but brought in their level of compliance and sort of hierarchical sort of decision making and processes that might work well for the banks, but really sort of kill innovation and slow down the platform to the point where it becomes barely more efficient than the bank.
Okay, thanks. So this question is a more simple question, but I assume some people in the room don't know it, so I'll try it. How does Lending Club get paid?
So we collect fees on both sides. So borrowers pay a one-time origination fee when they get the loan, and investors pay a servicing fee as they collect payments, or as we collect payment and pass them on to investors. And I think it's a pretty good way to charge fees at the time you're receiving money. So it doesn't feel, it just feels you're receiving less than you would, but you're not actually paying us. Mm-hmm. So that has worked well for us to charge an origination fee at the time the borrower gets a loan, and a servicing fee at the time the investor receives monthly payments.
But it's 1% of the payment.
So the origination fee is actually 4% and then the servicing fee is 1% of the payment.
That's right. So you still are getting roughly in the AAA credit, something like 5.5%.
That's right. Yep.
Okay. So this is a funny question, and it actually is dear to my heart because I remember I bought a book on this of how to do business in France. But the question is, can you describe doing business in France versus the U.S.?
How much time do you have? France is a wonderful country to retire. it's not a great country to do business in. I think you're missing everything you have here, right? So you're missing efficient access to capital and efficient capital markets and potential acquirer that would give the right incentives for investors to make the initial investment in the right place. I think there's not as good a ecosystem of universities, companies, and working together to really create that co-learning that I was referring to earlier. And then there's also this thing that's really self-sustaining is when you have a few successful entrepreneurs. Often they start making angel investments, so they make capital available to young entrepreneurs, and they often mentor young entrepreneurs. Or then when you have a successful entrepreneurial company, after 4 or 5 years, it gets bigger, and for some of the more entrepreneurial employees who were there at the beginning, I mean, first they made so much money on stock options that they don't want to work there anymore. But also sometimes the company gets bigger and they get a bit bored and they don't like the sort of higher level of processes, and so they go and leave and start something new, and you get cross pollination of bigger successful companies essentially having a lot of almost like little spin-offs and creating a bunch of new companies, so it's really self-sustaining that way. And then there are regulations, labor regulations in France, or I think they are well-intended and they're designed to protect employees, but they're so protective of employees that they create really a very high barrier to hiring employees. If you know that you're not going to be able to let go someone if you go through ups and downs, you're going to think twice about hiring that person in the first place. I think there's a much more fluid labor market in the U.S.
Okay, thanks. So we just have a few more. Do you think, this is a tough one, this is very tough.
Is it about Donald Trump?
No, no. What's the line? Huge. Do you think a huge company might buy Lending Club?
No. No, I hope Lending Club is going to become a huge company.
Okay. What is your advice on balancing the expectation of rapid growth in a company and, can't read this, but something to be with sustainable scalability?
Yeah, so I think we've been very deliberate in our growth plans, and we often haven't grown as fast as we could. We've sort of dialed growth to a level where we feel we are not growing too fast and don't have too much sort of risk of sort of making mistakes. So I think that's critical in a lot of businesses, but particularly in financial services, where mistakes can be very expensive for the company, but also just for our customers.
Okay, how do you monitor the borrower's business so that to decrease the credit risk?
Yeah, so we mostly do term loans, so there's not a lot of sort of ongoing monitoring in the sense that it's not a line of credit that we sort of can manage over time. So it's mostly a one-time underwriting decision where we look at all the information we have available at that time and make a decision for the next sort of 2 years, and then we have to live with that decision. But then, obviously, we have repeat customers, and so we use all the data we've collected over these 2 or 3 years to make the next lending decision. And then recently, we launched a small business line of credit product, where it's more of an ongoing monitoring, where we get a lot of data from the business, but also a lot of data about the business that we collect online. I think we're doing a lot of experiments about sort of online data and the online sort of footprint of the business, and sort of looking at Yelp reviews and sort of open table reviews for restaurants. And there are some really interesting things in the data. So going in, we thought businesses with sort of high ratings would probably be sort of better run businesses, their customers like them, they'd be more successful. We haven't actually found a correlation between sort of high Yelp ratings and good credit. We found correlations between the number of ratings and good credit, mm-hmm. and the pace at which a business accumulates new ratings and whether that pace accelerates or decelerates. So it's interesting when you start looking into the data, you discover sort of new correlations that might or might not make sense after the fact, but certainly were not necessarily sort of intuitive going in.
Okay, great. To end it, would you want to tell us a little bit about your journey to Hawaii? Anything special about that trip?
Yeah, no, it was a lot of fun. So it was a record, sailing record. We put a lot of sort of preparation into. I think the most fun thing about it is really the way you learn to live with sort of seven other people. So it was eight of us, and sort of going to Hawaii. Obviously, we're going as fast as we can. So we never stop the boat. So the boat keeps going all the time, and we have four people on deck and four people sleeping. Then we switch every 4 hours. So the guys who are sort of on deck for 4 hours, you can imagine that at the end of the 4 hours, they are like completely sort of wet and tired, especially at night. But then we're always trying to sort of create new and exciting ways to wake up the other four guys who are sleeping.
Do you want to share what are some of the exciting ways?
Well, it ended up with buckets of ice water.
Oh, well, wow. That'll get them going.
Yes.
Okay, thank you very much. It was a pleasure having you.
Yeah, thank you.